Sagen Sie jetzt mal bitte Anarchie.
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 Ob geschichtlich oder brandaktuell.
Mit Berichten und Interviews, mit Beiträgen und Collagen
beleuchtet das anarchistische Radio Berlin das Phänomen des Anarchismus.
Viva Anarchia!
As part of a journey through Eastern Europe, a member of the Anarchist Radio Berlin had the opportunity of talking to a comrade of the housing project Syrena about the tenants' movement in Warsaw. The main topics of this interview were the history of reprivatization through ruthless landlords and local authorities in Warsaw, like in the case of the murder of the tenants' activist Jolanta Pszerska in 2011, as well as the wild tenant struggles against these mechanisms and their cooperation with the anarchist movement regarding the rising rents. Additionally, our friend told us some interesting facts about the development of Warsaw's city structure, especially its rebuilding in terms of communal housings under the Soviet regime.
Hello, Bartek.
Hey.
Welcome.
Hey, how are you?
We are sitting here again in Sirena Squad. Bartek, you are anarchist as well as activist in a tenants' movement of Warsaw. Could you tell us first a little bit about your personal stories and your beginnings?
Mm-hmm.
Which this kind of activism?
Well, just to start, I'm trying to defy both of the terms, both a squatter and an anarchist, and it's strictly connected to the struggle here in Warsaw that we are having, and with the place that we are in, meaning Sirena Squad, and the reason why we try to, and me personally also have been trying to defy the term of squatter is that there's several reasons, but first one is that in Polish, usually the term squatter refers to a word that is borrowed and is kind of a historical word, and thanks to this, probably it mostly refers to this kind of subcultural squatting scene and stuff. And we as Sirena, because of the history of this place, we are more into using another term that is far more rooted in the history of Warsaw and in the history of this building exactly, in particular, meaning like it's a dziki lokator, meaning like a wild tenant, and we use it because like plenty of people in the city who have been actually squatting the empty buildings. But are not part of the scene, even don't know English and stuff, and have never used this term to identify themselves with a squatter. So they usually been using, or they have been called with the reference of this term of a wild tenant. So like in this building, for example, like in 1940, we are just a second wave of squatters, yeah? Wow. And the first wave appeared in 1945, and this was the biggest wave of occupying of empty buildings. Actually, it was occupying of ruins. And in this moment, actually, 1945, just after the war, in Vita 30 building, where we are here, where we are now, there's there've been 50 people living and not paying for living, and reconstructing the building and stuff. Yeah, and they also didn't call themselves squatters using this name, and that is being used right now, like since maybe beginning of 90s.
Yeah.
And like squatting scene as like a subcultural scene have been much influenced by Berlin, and like there's plenty of people in the 90s coming from Berlin and coming back and using like some like concepts from what they've seen there in this like big wave of squatting in Germany and especially in Berlin. But we consider this term like very, very not rooted in the history of our place, yeah. And we are trying to set up ourselves in this in the history of this city. And we think, and I think that using the term wild tenant is much more influential in our environment, because every people that every family that lives around and have been living here for at least like 60, 70 years, they know the term much more, and they themselves have this kind of experience of occupying empty buildings, especially in 1945. And this actually, this huge wave, the biggest wave of squatting, of occupying empty places, in 1945, was actually like very, very influential as far as the character of the city is concerned. So it was like very, very important for the character of the place, and also this kind of energy that was put on the ground at that time. Somehow refers to what we are dealing right now, because like plenty of people tried to restore the like all the city after the war, and right now the people that use all the like free time to reconstruct the buildings and stuff, they are the ones that are now being evicted, you know. Mm-hmm. They are the white tenants which are part of our history also, because we are also like, you know, fighting eviction and stuff. Yeah. So we are trying to, just to put it short, to defy the term of squatting and put it more in the like in the context of our streets and our environment, and in this way we feel much more much bigger connection to the people around.
An important person in the last years has been Jolana Preska. Yeah. She was murdered in 2011.
2011 in March. Yes. Yeah.
What can you tell us about this story of this development?
The story of Jolana Preska is crucial also for us as people living here in Serena, because we squatted this building just like one week or 2 weeks after her killing. Mm-hmm. And basically, Jolana Preska was also one of the people whose father actually was a squatter in 1945. He reconstructed the building in Mokotów district, in which later on the authorities allowed him and his family to live. Igrapreska, as a kid, she started living there. This was the, like, basically, like, before the war, just to put it in a bigger context, like 97% of Warsaw was in private hands. Wow. There was no council housing, no communal housing and stuff. Yeah, and only after the war, after like legalizing of the white tenants, like of this huge wave of people that came back, along with also and like meaning that father of Jola Preska was also part of this wave. Legalizing of these white tenants quarters paved way to communal housing, the first time in history of Warsaw. Mm-hmm. And Poland as such also. So then like all the land was communalized. Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll speak maybe more about like the process in which it happened. But like let's move a little bit more, like 70 years or 60 years. To these times, when Jolana Preska is in her 60s, and like her building, reconstructed totally by her father, was seized by a company. It's a mafia. In 2009, in 2003. The guy is called Mosakowski. He's like a chief of this kind of a quasi company. He's like one of the most influential people right now in Warsaw, because he's got around like 60 buildings himself. And there's plenty of these kind of mafias that try to reprivatize the buildings. I will tell about this process in more detail later on. But basically, Jolana Preska was like one of the most charismatic persons in the people in the tenants movement. She started being like active with securing her own house, fighting against the eviction. Then she started organizing along with the tenants living in her own like house. A building, and then later on she started to organize along with the people that have been also seized along with the buildings by the same company, and that's when a Warsaw Tenants Association was was initiated, and I also take part in the actions of the group. So like basically Warsaw Tenants Association is one of the biggest and like rooted in a like radical tools of fighting, collective in Warsaw that's fighting for housing, and Jola Breska was the initiator of this this association, and later on because she was like very very charismatic, and she like the landowner landlord wasn't able to evict her, and she also she boycotted the rent that was heightened like 10 times or so, or 11 times as far as I believe, she was very good in organizing in the streets along with organizing in a legal way. And she fought since the beginning of this housing struggle in Warsaw until the end, because she was taken from her house on 1st of March 2011 and taken to the forest and burned alive like a witch. Basically, like since that moment, this the tenants' movement, if we can speak about the movement, got like very very radicalized, and it's actually the older folks that were like far more radical than the young people that maybe supported them, like, you know, the anarchists, declarative anarchists. Actually, I myself have been radicalized by this generation of people who are like in a big and a huge problem, like, you know, masses of people are being evicted, and masses of around 2,500 buildings have already been appropriated, and in each of the buildings there's around like 17 families, and young people mostly, like they go out, so there's plenty of migration from Poland to Germany, England and stuff, but all the folks stay because they can't go and work, you know. So when they stay, they also they feel that they are just next to the wall, and that's why they use like the most radical tools to fight against evictions and stuff. And I myself, I was also like I never like belonged to this I don't know, like how do you call it, like anarchist scene as such. But I was radicalized firstly by the fact that there's the housing policy in Poland is totally shitty. It's like a bankocracy, and that's why plenty of people, along with myself, try to, when they are like in their 18, 19, 20 and stuff, they migrate to Western Europe to earn some money. Sometimes they never come back. And then on the other side, you got these older folks that fight against evictions from the communal housing that is being shrinked a lot. Somehow these two currents met, especially after Jola Breska's killing, and we are like part of this story of connection of like young and older folks, and older folks. I remember like these two older women when we occupied, just like 2 days after we found that it's her body that has been burned. We occupied a district council in the other side of the river, on the right side of Warsaw. And then I remember the words of two older women that came to the megaphone, and one of them mentioned that now is the time to throw out our canes and take the crowbars, you know, because she had a cane. And it's like it was a big signal for many people that, like, you know, people don't want to organize in a kind of NGO manner anymore. No demonstrations, like we need to take up, you know, in a more like direct action. Mm-hmm. And organize ourselves without asking the authorities to, you know, to change the policy, housing policy and stuff, because like part of the picture of mass evictions and reprivatization is empty buildings. There's you know, plenty of empty buildings in the city. We can block evictions, we can occupy the city councils and stuff, but we can also occupy the buildings that have already been cleansed. Jola Breska was like, I don't know, the moment of her killing was a very very important moment in the dynamics of the housing movement in Warsaw. And not only in Warsaw.
I can imagine, yes. And what was the reaction of the local authorities about this case of Jola?
Mostly thanks to people like Jola Breska and the housing collectives, the authorities needed to change their narrative about the tenants, because usually they somehow add a kind of symbolic violence to the physical violence of the evictions, saying that the tenants are usually the alcoholics and stuff. Yeah, mm-hmm. Since the time when austerity was invented, people that were more poor were called called like beasts and stuff, yeah. And the story of the narrative of tenants is the same actually. So thanks to organizing of the people like Yola, the narrative has changed. But then when she was killed, both police and the authorities said that probably she committed suicide, mm-hmm. which wasn't believed by anybody of her friends. Actually, even the journalists didn't believe the story, but the authorities and the prosecutor and the police for 8 months they claimed that it was a suicide, and only after 8 months they changed the story, saying that it was a murder, but then they don't have any traits.
Okay.
Because they didn't secure any traits, because since the first day they mentioned that it's a suicide, and that's why they just they wanted to close the case. But due to plenty of protests in all around the city, they were pressed to dig a little bit more at least. So finally they said, okay, they admitted it's a murder, but they never accused any particular person. And probably we know who are the people that that Yola threatened by living just in her house, and who are the people due to which Yola was presented a problem, and probably these are the people that killed Yola, but at the same time we can't say that they are just like few rotten apples and stuff. It's like a systemic case, and the authorities paved the way to what happened with Yola and to what is going on with all the people right now in thousands of buildings in the city. Basically, just to put the story in a bigger historical context, because we are speaking about reprivatization, and it's like strictly connected to the kind of manipulation of the authorities and the house cleansers, the developers, saying that they want to they use this term that they want to bring back the charm of pre-war Warsaw, and that's why they are reprivatizing the city. And they forget about the fact that that in pre-war Warsaw, housing problem was huge, absolutely huge. If we look at the Second World War, not as a coming out of a devil, but as a kind of historical materialist perspective, and then we can really admit that it was just accumulation of all these economic and social problems that also were at the core of the imagination of the people here in Warsaw, because the city of Warsaw before the war in 1939 was the most densely populated city in Europe and both Americas, and most of the people lived, especially the working class people, lived in around 4 or 5 people in apartment that consisted of one room, yeah. It's a mixture of kitchen and a room, housing rents were very, very high. So there was plenty of housing strikes before the war. The nationalists, along with the landlords, used this kind of situation, instrumentalizing this narrative of anti-Semitism, saying that we just need to get rid of the Jews, which comprised around 40% of the city of Warsaw, and then we have place for everybody. Yeah. But on the other side, the Jews were also part of this of the working class, and they also shared this the condition of living of the working class that I mentioned described in detail, after the war, when this kind of discourse really worked and most of the Jews were actually killed, also the city was totally smashed. Yeah. I mean, so the Jewish ghetto was absolutely totally destroyed, 100%. In the old town, I got this, I can describe, this is the map of the old town. or the plan of this district of the city, just after the war, where they say that the blue are the buildings that survived. And okay. Can you see any blue? Like,
not,
you know,
like not
one,
much,
yeah,
not
one
not
in a hundred. Yeah, and all of it is in red. So all the city was, all this of the district was destroyed.
Less, yes.
Yeah. So in this district of the old town, around one apartment in 15 survived. And in the district where we live right now, there's around one apartment in 7 that survived.
Okay.
This this building in which we live right now, it was claimed to be too destroyed to restore. Yeah. So the authorities wanted to erase it. Also, Jolaj Brzeska's building was claimed that it needs to be destroyed because like it was totally smashed. Only the front walls and part of the roof survived, and only the fundaments. But then they wasn't the buildings that were not destroyed because of the people that moved in, because like it was winter, and just after Warsaw was liberated, immediately people flew in and started to live in the ruins among them, and they even broke the rule of the military. The president of the city was actually a general. So he said that there's no way to go to the left side of the river because there's plenty of mines, probably. Like, but on the other side, the authorities didn't want people here because they had their own plan to reconstruct the city. But people flew in a huge wave, and they squatted like this building. There's 50 people living here and the building of Jolaj Brzeska. And they use plenty of work. It's estimated that around 50 million hours of unpaid work were spent in the time of reconstruction of the city between 45 and 59. Around 70 billion zlotys were spent to reconstruct the city, which is around 18 billion euro. Buildings from other cities like Wrocław, which was also quite destroyed, as Festung Breslau, part of the city of Wrocław was actually deconstructed in order to have bricks to rebuild Warsaw. Yeah. And also people from all over the country contributed by paying some money to reconstruct it. So it's like Warsaw is actually an effect of a huge social work. Plenty of unpaid hours of work, plenty of money from the public budget, and then people like believe that after they reconstruct it, they can live in peace in this kind of communalized housing. All the land was communalized, so there was like a huge, absolutely huge difference as far as power dynamics concerned, from before the war, when 97% of Warsaw was in private hands, to after the war, when 100% of city was in was communalized. Mm-hmm. Since 40s, 50s, 60s, you needed to pay, you need to work around like 3-4 days a month to pay the rent. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then transformation happened. In 1989, and they started to privatize everything, like all the working places, but also buildings, and they utilized this kind of narrative of reprivatization, saying that what is justice is that the descendants of the landlords from before the war, they need to have the buildings back. Okay. But the problem is that it's not the descendants that have paid and they didn't also work in reconstructing the city, but it's like mostly the people that actually lived in the buildings, the tenants. Second thing is that actually, before the war, most of the, just right now, you when you buy an apartment, you don't have money to buy it, but you get a loan from the bank. So from before the war, also the landlords actually had mortgages on the buildings, and the mortgages were annulled, were cancelled. Yes. So the tenants come and get the buildings that were restored, reconstructed by the people and without the mortgages, you know. And the third problem is that it's not the descendants that come and claim the buildings, but it's professional mafias that that falsify some kind of archival documents. And, you know, these are also sometimes people that we call like descendants of Szmalcowniki. Szmalcowniki were the people that during the war they sabotaged the Jews that wanted to escape from the ghetto or stuff, and they wanted to survive, and they paid all that they could to survive. The Szmalcowniki, Polish people living in Warsaw, they tortured, they sabotaged the Jews, and sometimes they also were given the documents of the ownership of the buildings of the Jews. So basically it's either mafias, big companies, huge corporations, multinational corporations, and this descendants of Szmalcowniki that claim and claim to restore the pre-war charm of Warsaw. Yeah.
How would you describe this process of reprivatization, which is going on since 1990 till now, and which is still going on? In some short sentences?
Yeah, it's actually, I wouldn't call it gentrification, because the scale is so big that it's more, it resembles more like, a huge land grab, because it's 97% of pre-war Warsaw, yeah? So literally all the city, not only buildings, but like parks, schools, 100 schools from the city center are going to be evicted because the landlords from before the war claimed the land. So it's a huge land grabbing, and it's also not a unique protest, not an aberration in this kind of atmosphere after the transformation, because it fits the image of privatizing like all the working spaces and stuff. Yeah. To put it short, it's a massive criminal land grab, and that we try to oppose, and that Jola Brzeska tried to. Had been tried to oppose until she was killed. Also all the authorities are somehow like from each of the options they didn't do anything to stop it. So they usually like just before the elections. So like right now in October we got elections. So they say that maybe they want to regulate it in a way that they would have a kind of a rule. Saying that you can't claim the building, but you can have a compensation of like 15% or stuff, but they never do it. They there was like six projects of this kind of rule since a couple of years, and they never actually introduced it. So the only thing we can do is to organize in a grassroots manner, either instantly blocking the evictions that are going on all around the city, occupying the houses that have already been cleansed of the people, and like occupying the councils, like, you know, this kind of pressure is the thing that that we are into a lot, along with the people. Like on Saturday, so in 3 days, there's Tenants' Day in Warsaw, in which we also, along with the other groups of tenants, we are organizing some kind of like a street theater to speak about it and to set up a little bit of pressure. We also starting 10th of October we are doing a kind of exhibition, putting it in a detail, using the materials from 1945, telling all the story of communalizing and the story of reprivatizing. So this is what we do.
So, and do you have nevertheless any expectations in regard to the following elections?
Well, no expectations as far as particular parties concerned. Basically not at all. Somehow, the far right right now is trying to be more social, and then try to utilize this kind of language, like anti-bank language and stuff, just like in Hungary. They got a problem because they are never anti-property, and they are very, very into private property and stuff, the far right. And as far as tenants concerned, they are like, you know, they live in communal housing, so they don't have, like, many of them don't want to live in private apartments. They want to pay lower rent and stay just like now. But I know that that many political parties follow the path of what Margaret Thatcher did in England, by also apart from reprivatization, they want to privatize the management of the tenement housing. Mm-hmm. So right now the management is public, and they know that if they say that they privatize everything, people will not agree. So they want to keep the ownership public, but they want to privatize the management. And probably, like in England, it happened in the 80s. There's plenty of companies that are going to manage housing. So there will not be one movement against one company, which is right now public. But it's going to be dispersed. And for this reason, probably it's going to be easier for them to privatize it, everything, like all the housing, because they will destroy this kind of consolidation that we got right now. So to put it short, I don't believe in that anything better will happen. I feel that actually something worse might happen as far as we can count on the, like, political parties.
Thank you, Bartek, for this impressive interview. Do you want to add something special?
Yeah, I just got, like, saying also about, like, defying this closed alienating identity of squatter. I think that is also actually part of the problem, that that for years, I don't know, so like for 20 years at least in Warsaw, anarchist movement wasn't that much involved in it, and was like more into celebrating its identity without looking at what's going on in the neighborhood. And it's like, basically, I still feel that it's a huge problem, because, like, in the late 90s, like, along with this Alter Global protest, Polish anarchist scene joined the protests of the groups from Germany and other people. But actually, you know, as far as Alter Globalism is concerned, I feel that what the conditions are in Mexico and Latin America are quite the same here in Poland, and it's like, it's absurd to, I mean, of course, like the kind of international condition and identity is crucial, but we need to, you know, to come back to our own environment and not to exotize our identity, and, like, you know, it's kind of escapism that has been going on for a lot of years as far as anarchist movement is concerned right now. So that's why also Sirena is not a part of Anarchist Federation, which hasn't been very, very much active in Warsaw, unlike in Poznan, when, like, in Poznan somehow I feel that since the 90s the group evolved internally. There was, like, one group, a strong group that evolved from the subcultural anarchist identity to a, like, political, social a movement that is going on right now. And in Warsaw, it's like, when we occupy this house, like, I feel that most of the anarchy groups that declare themselves as anarchists, they haven't been doing much as far as their own, like, neighborhood is concerned.
I noticed it also, that the anarchist movement in Warsaw don't have such an avant-garde role or something like that. That could be positive, I think, in work with society, with the citizens.
Yeah, of course. But I feel also that often we mention that Warsaw is closer to Berlin than Poznan, even though, like, geographically Poznan is closer, because, like, Warsaw have been for years much more into, like, lifestyle anarchism, and maybe right now it's not an avant-garde, but it's always, the situation is very, very dynamic, and I feel like, you know, it's a matter of your everyday consciousness not to go into avant-garde and be, like, connected with the struggles of the other people, anti-capitalist struggles. And so that's why we are anarchists by substance and by the tools that we use. But we, you know, we don't declare, you know, it by the like formal identity of clothing and stuff. Yeah.
Not some kind of label politics.
Yeah.
Like in other cities or
yeah.
movements or
yeah.
nations. Yes.
Yeah, it's quite harming, I think.
Thank you, Bartek.
Yeah, thank you.
Bye bye.
Hey, ciao.